It gives me peace and it calms my heart to help others. Yes. If I'm helping others, it's God's way of saying, this is your path, Mill. It's not an easy one all the time, but it's your path, and it's it's what He's chosen for me, and I accept it, and I embrace it. She's a lady. She's a lady.
Talking about that little lady. Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming back to Just Us Grown Up Girls. I have a really exciting guest today. Her name is Mildred Kerner, and she lives in a small town called Morrisville, PA. It's in Bucks County, and this is actually where I grew up. So we go way back to elementary school through high school. And then after high school, I left town, but she stayed, and she has made quite an impression, quite an impact on the whole town in many ways. She's an amazing, energized person, and I'm so excited for you to meet her. So come on in, Mildred.
Hello, Rose.
Hello. I'm so happy to see you.
I'm so happy to be here. Thank you for thinking I'm exciting.
Yes. See how she just lights up the whole screen? This is the Mildred I remember back in elementary school. I still have a vision of you, little skinny girl in your uniform, Holy Trinity,
navy blue socks
uniform, and big teethy smile, always, always. And I also remember that some people confused us.
Yes.
Some people thought we were sisters or the same person because of the dark hair and the bright eyes. I think your eyes are more electrifying than mine, but you know, the same big teethy smile. And back then I used to have a thinner face, a little more narrow like yours, but now I'm nice and round, so maybe we don't look so much alike. So anyway, Mildred, I think you are the most outgoing, social, big-hearted person I know.
Why, thank you.
Really, yes. And we've been Facebook friends for a while, and my head spins sometimes when I see Mildred's post. I mean, there was one day recently where in the morning she was on a field trip with the seniors at the mall, and then she showed herself driving to work. You work at Giant.
Yeah, it was the Giant Dream.
Yes. Mm. And then that evening you were at a painting party with all the Kerner
women.
Kerner
girls, the Kerner girls.
Yes. And then after that you showed a picture of a fire pit.
Yep, went to my niece's to burn some fire.
Yeah. And, all that in one day. I mean, and that's not
unusual. That's very typical for me. Yeah, I wake up and I manage my time, but I like to manage a lot of things in my time.
Yes.
So I do things that are fun and and that I love to do, but I make it so that I have time for everything.
Yes.
So I was worked in a newspaper as a manager, so I had to manage my time properly that way in order to get the newspaper delivered in a timely fashion, you know, with all my carriers and stuff. That was back when paper boys delivered the newspaper.
Yes, I would be their paper manager. I remember those days.
Yes. Yeah. Matter of fact, one of my paper boys came into Giant on Thursday, and he looked at me and he says, "Are you Milli?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I'm Milli." And he says, "You don't remember me, do you?" I says, "Well, your face looks kind of familiar." And he says, "You used to be my paper manager." I said, "Oh, my heavens, where?" And he said, "In Ewing." He said, "I'm Brandon." I'm like, "Oh, Brandon, how are you? How's your mom?" He says, "You still look the same." And I haven't worked at the newspaper for 30 years.
Oh, my gosh. You really do.
And I'm like, so it was so nice to see him. Yes. And then he remembered, and he was like, you know, "Thank you for, you know, helping me form," because he lived in not such, you know, good conditions, and I would help him, you know, to make some good decisions and good choices in his life, in their lives.
So you were more than just a workman.
I did, and it was,
you reached him.
Yes, and then a lot of my carriers I still have relationships with because they had struggles, and I helped to ease their struggles or to help them find a fit with someone else that would help their quandary.
That's Mildred for you. I call her Mildred back in the day, but everybody else calls her Milli.
Milli with an I.
Yes. So, Mildred, can you just give me a little list of all the activities you do?
Well, I'm an elk. I'm a lion. I work for a nonprofit called the Ivins Outreach Center in Morrisville. We're a resource and referral service, so people can come into our place and we can help them navigate through anything: hunger, health, homelessness, wow, education, veterans affairs. We have the fodder for them to get complete. I had a veteran come in riding on a bicycle. And he came in and he says, "I'm a vet and I'm riding on this bicycle." And I said, "Well, let me." And so I gave him all the information he needed. And he went out and used all the resources I gave him. He drove up in a car the next month and he came in and he thanked me. He says, "Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. If I hadn't stopped here and asked for the information to help me navigate through to better my life, I'd still be riding that bicycle."
Wow.
So he came in to thank us. And that was, that was a nice thing.
Right. This Ivins Outreach, is that... located in Morrisville?
Yeah, Ivins Outreach Center is at 80 West Trenton Avenue in Morrisville. We've been there since 1992. I did volunteer for 12 years before I came on to the Staying Put. The Staying Put in Lower Bucks County program is a program that I helped to run. It's for people, I can't say seniors, because it's for people from 55 and up who don't have anyone to get them to their doctor's appointment or to come over and sit with them and chit-chat. And three times a month I take them out and we go to the movies or we go shopping or we go, you know, to get ice cream, you know. It's so I leave it up to them, the activities that they like. They love museums, so we go to museums and such.
And I saw a little video. I looked up Ivins Outreach and you were delivering food.
Yes, we deliver over Christmas. We have this because we do the 21st century programs are with the Ivins Outreach Center as well. So for the holiday season, the students make ornaments for all the Staying Put members and they make them wreaths and different gifts. So we pack them all into our Ivins bus and we drive around to all the seniors and we give them, we sing them Christmas carols or seasonal carols.
That is so great.
And you know, and it's wonderful. I mean, our the ranges that we have at the Staying Put are from 50, I have a 100-year-old. She's going to be 101 next year, and I can't keep up, next month, and I can't keep up with her.
Oh, my gosh.
She's come shopping in Giant, and I said, "Bernice, what are you doing? It's the hottest day of the year." She said, "Well, I needed some things." I said, "You have my cell phone. You should call me. I want to come get you." But, you know, it's just rewarding to help.
Yes.
You know, it's
sure
just
is
in my nature.
It sure is. Yeah. It just oozes out of you, your generous spirit. Yeah. Really.
Thank you.
And Ivins Outreach, this Staying Put program, when I first saw that name, I thought, Staying Put, do you want the seniors?
What it is, older is we want them to remain in their homes and age gracefully at home instead of going to senior housing.
Yes.
But we do have people that live, we have people live in Sunrise, we have them live in Chandler Hall, Attleboro, that they join us just to come to the outings with us. I mean, they say, I don't care if you're going to come pick me up, take me around the block, come and get me, you know, and it's just... so nice to take them out.
It sure is.
And they, I see, I look in my mirror and I see them, you know, exchanging phone numbers. Are you going to be home this weekend? You know, call me. And they have foreign friendships themselves, you know, which is what it's all about.
Because
socialization is key to longevity.
Yes, certainly. Yeah, and the fact that you can help people stay in their own home.
Yes.
No, not everyone wants to go out and live in a hall or a senior center. Yeah, it's really nice. Yes. So you do those activities. What else do you do?
I am an elk. So the Elks, I have been a, let's see, I was a chaplain for 7 years. I was the leading knight and I was the loyal knight. The Elks Lodge is a wonderful organization that helps, our cause is cerebral palsy. So we help people with cerebral palsy in many different ways, you know, through education and such.
Okay.
And then the Lions Club, I was the president of that for a couple of years. And we help people with sight and hearing. So I did a big campaign through all the schools to have awareness of the Lions Club, because these organizations, these civic organizations, are really losing their appeal with the millennials, because they don't think that the volunteer is important. They all want this instant gratification, and it's like when you can get gratification from somebody smiling out of something you did, and that's
rewarding.
It's worth more than money.
Yes, and when you put your head on the pillow at night.
Oh yeah.
You feel good.
Yeah, and people say, oh, I can't go to sleep. No, I said, let my head down and I go to sleep.
Well, you must be exhausted.
I fill my day up. I do a complete day. I get up and, you know, make the beds, get the shower, start the day. And, you know, it's always, I'm very busy. But I like, it's busy good.
Yes.
And it's busy good. And also, I just started a Nar-non meeting over in Morrisville.
Okay, Nar-non.
Nar-non is a group that helps families that are struggling with a friend's or family member's addiction. Mm-hmm. And I, of course, lost my daughter to addiction. It'll be 5 years in February. I miss her dearly. But helping others that are struggling with their addicts, it's rewarding for me to help them because the struggle is real. You know, that we, as people that love addicts, we get addicted to their addiction, and then we have to find, and this program is a 12-step program through Nar-non, and it helps us to become us again. It's a step program, so like the first step, you know, you admit it, you're powerless, and then, you know, step two, you know, had a moral, and you go through all the steps, and, you know, you get a sponsor, but just helping people, like I'm 24/7, people can call me, they know my phone. When my phone rings, I answer. I answer for people that are in crisis because addicts, you know, they don't have a time schedule. So sometimes their crisis is at, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning when, you know, he's banging on my door, what do I do? I said, well, if you want me, I'll call the police. However I can help them.
Right.
But yeah, so I'm an elk, I'm a lion. I volunteer with my church. I sing in the choir.
You do?
11 o'clock mass, yes. I do. I sing at the funeral choir too as well.
Oh my goodness.
So.
Wow, I didn't know about all those. Amazing. So you were talking about your daughter.
Yes.
I certainly understand that. I had a brother, Johnny.
Johnny's a nice kid.
Yeah.
Well, man.
Yeah, well he died. He had a heroin overdose. It's been about 21 years now. I know that because he died a week before my son was born. And so that date is always there in my mind. Mm-hmm. That time of year is always there when you remember. And when it happened, my parents were never the same. It just destroyed them. So
you see, yeah. I dealt with my daughter's addiction. Like, she was very open with me. She would tell me, you know, Mom, I don't want to do this. I don't want to be like this. You know, and I tell her, you're better than this. She says, I know, but I just can't stop. Mm-hmm. I said, no, you won't stop. I said, you could stop if you really put that thought into your mind and went positive. She was in every rehab. She was in Eagleville, Living Green, Malvern. She just wouldn't go to the long term. That's right. You have to go to a long term rehab.
Yes.
30-day is a band-aid, and it's when they leave rehab, if they're an opiate abuser, they should get the Vivitrol shot. So that is a blocker. They can't get high if they want to get high. And she did do the Vivitrol, and she suffered for 5 years with her addiction, my daughter did.
Yeah,
and when she did the
terrible.
Vivitrol shot, she was herself again. She went back to school. She got her certificates. She was, you know, she got her certificate for knowledge of the mouth. She wanted to be a dentist or a dental assistant. So she got her certificate for radiology and the knowledge of the mouth. And she went down to this dentist in Philadelphia. And he let her work as an dental assistant.
Yes.
But she loved it. She loved dressing up in her scrubs and going to work. And it was like she was holding him. But then, you know, she stopped doing the Vivitrol and she just went back to getting high. And she's like, Mom, I just like to get high. And I said, Mel, if you like to get high so much, I can't help you. And then she went to jail. When I saw her in jail, that was very hard. Because, you know, you don't want to see your kids in prison arms.
No.
And she said, no, this is not the first jail I've been in. I was like, what?
She's like, and still, even that was not rock bottom enough.
Nope.
That chemical addiction
takes the dopamine in your brain 24 months to regenerate until you can function, until your brain functions properly. So it takes that long.
Mm-hmm.
So these 30-day programs are not really worth it for an opiate. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's different with cocaine and other drugs, but with the opiate, your brain needs 24 months to reorganize and reprogram.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, found her on the day after Valentine's mm-hmm. Day. We had a wonderful Valentine's Day mm-hmm. dinner. Well, I worked at Giant. I came home. Jeff was in his office then. Mm-hmm. And we had a beautiful dinner. Of course, Jeffrey had his chicken nuggets mm-hmm. and french fries before mm-hmm. before I got here. And
you're mentioning these names. So Jeff is your husband.
Jeff is my husband. Yes. Jeffrey is my son. Jeffrey's yes. 15 in the 10th mm-hmm. grade.
Yes.
And just a good kid.
Yes. And he looks just like you.
I know. He's like my he and really his hair, he's, I said, Jeffrey, you need to get, you know, a haircut. No, not cut my hair. Yeah.
There's more important battles.
Oh yes. Pick your battles. Pick your battles. Right. You don't need to sign mm-hmm. up for everything mm-hmm. that comes your way.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so, always put a positive spin on everything. Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. that's what gets me yes. through.
That's why I wanted you on the show, because your positivity, your energy, your light just shines, and everyone needs to see that and learn from it. So speaking of family, Mildred comes from a huge family, and if you grew up in Morrisville, you would know the name of Kerner. They're everywhere.
Kerner on every corner.
Yes, and many of them have stayed in the area.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm number 7 of 9. I have 6 older brothers and 2 younger sisters. All my brothers were in Morrisville at one time, till my brother left for the Navy, and then, you know, the Navy took Billy to Florida, to California. Okay. Joey was in the Air Force. So they were both in mm-hmm. Vietnam at the same time. My brother Bob was in an awful automobile accident when he was 16, 17, and he was in the hospital for a year of his life. He had fractured his hip mm-hmm. and broke bones, and he was mm-hmm. you know, on life support, came home. We had a hospital bed in the dining room for wow. years while his legs were in traction mm. and then Freddie, you know, the draft was over then, so Freddie mm-hmm. and Michael, they came, and Freddie went to the steel mill, Michael went with the railroad, Victor was steel mill with Freddie, and they look so okay. much alike. Freddie and Victor look like twins, so they used yes. to trade each other's badges to mm-hmm. get into the steel mill. If they forgot theirs, mm-hmm. they would just use. So they could use the same
really?
Badge. Yeah,
oh
they would look so much alike.
Huh.
Yes, and then, you know, my brother Vic died in a car crash when he was 29 back in 1988. He said to my mother that he loved to be 29. He wished he could be 29 forever, and he died 2 weeks before his 30th birthday. So I never say that I like to be any age. I love right. every age I am.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like... Yes. 29 forever.
Yeah. I'm 39 forever.
There you go.
Actually, I don't even try that anymore.
Yes.
I'm 60 now, and I'm 60. Who cares? You know, what's the alternative?
Yes.
You know? So I'm happy to be 60 and doing what I'm doing and
yep.
being
me too.
With people and giving. And
when I tell people yeah. how old I am, they're like, no way.
I know.
Get out.
You're 59?
I'll be 59 next
okay.
month.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, no way.
Yeah.
You look the same as you did in high school, really.
It was funny at work the other day, one of the cashier's boyfriends were there, and they're 18, right?
Uh-huh.
And so I was like joshing with him. He's like, man, she was pretty good looking for an old lady.
That's a good
one. Well,
is that your natural hair?
No.
Do you color your hair?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Every 4 weeks, I'm in the chair.
Okay, yeah, me too.
Yes.
I have, sometimes it's 2 weeks.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah,
if
no,
I just let it go, I'd be all gray.
Yeah, if I would be pure white. My mother says she really wants me to be pure, because she's
really?
Pure white, my mom, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I'll show a picture of her on the screen.
Yes, yeah, so I'm like, she says, when are you going to go like me? I said, when there's not a bottle on the shelf. Until then, I will be my...
Yes.
Mousy Brown.
Yeah. I would like to do it someday, but I'm just not ready
not
now.
Ready.
And some
no.
of our friends have gone gray.
Oh, yeah.
And they look good.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just not ready.
No, I'm not ready to take my length
no.
down. Or,
no.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. Right. Mm-mm. Speaking of your mother,
yes.
I know she is such a big central
She's the catalyst
force.
Of us. She's
yes.
She's our focal. She's our strength. She mm-hmm. is what made us.
Mm-hmm.
I love my mom. She's still my traveling partner. We were out last night, and last week we were out 3 nights a week. Same week we were out, and I said, oh my heavens, But she's 90 and she's still going. So, yeah. You know, I, you know, Mom, do you want to go? Or I'll say to her, Mom, can we do lunch? And she looks in her book, in her little Bible thing.
Good for her.
So, oh, Mill, I'm filled every day this week. I'm like, oh, can you pencil me in for next week, Mom?
Oh my gosh, that's awesome. She still drives.
She still drives. Yeah. She's still on the board at the senior center in Morrisville. She's the secretary of Holy Trinity Seniors.
Oh my goodness, she keeps very active.
She has, you know, her friends that, you know, she's just a go-getter.
Yes. I wonder where you got that.
Yes. I didn't fall too far from that turnip truck.
Yeah. Right. Right. Okay. With a big family like that, Mildred, how do you handle Christmas?
Well, Christmas is always at my brother Mike's house. He has open house on Christmas.
Okay.
All the kids do a Pollyanna. Well, okay. My mother has 19 grandchildren. She has, I think it might be 26 now, great-grandchildren. And one great-great-grandchild.
Oh, my goodness.
So, and she buys for every one of them at Christmas.
She does.
She gives them all a $5 lottery ticket.
Aww.
And, you know, little tchotchkes,
yes.
You know.
Yes.
And
she enjoys shopping and giving.
And every one of their birthdays, she knows when yesterday she had a pile of cards because this month, October and November, it's about, I think 9 of the grandchildren, great-grands and greats are from October to November,
right.
The end of November. So she had a pile of cards.
That's a lot of cards.
So she, you know, and she remembers every one of them. And, you know, I'm just blessed that she still has her wits.
Yes.
I mean, my father died 31 years ago, because him and Victor died 6 months apart. He died of Alzheimer's disease at 65 years old. So it was pretty rough on my mom, you know, to have someone with limited capacity. Now my brother, Bill, is demonstrating some of the same symptoms. So we're doctoring with him. But so my mom's been alone. Every time she goes to the hospital for a procedure, which is not very often, I always pack her with some sexy pajamas. And
she says,
what are you doing? I said, I want you to bring me home a doctor when you come home.
She
said, put them flannels in the bag. I'm not wearing them sexy pajamas.
Oh my gosh, you're crazy.
Yeah, so she's like, don't even go there, Mel.
And she really has her physicality about her.
Oh, yes, she still drives.
Wow.
Yeah, she uses her walker, but she, you know, she takes her walker, opens up the trunk, you know, throws it in, goes around, puts it in, she comes out, and then, like, when she goes to the center, she leaves it lifted a little bit. So when she comes out of the center, she just puts her walker in and drives on home.
Wow.
And,
amazing.
But now when she comes home, I say to her, Mom, call me when you get home, because she's getting a little, her navigation, she's slowing down.
Yeah.
And she fell the one day coming up to go in the house, and she didn't fall. She said, I felt myself going down, so I just sat on the ground. And then one of the neighbors was driving by, and he saw her on the ground, so he stopped, and he got out. He said, Mrs. Kerner, and she said, I'm fine. I felt like I was going to fall, so I just sat on the ground. I'm fine. So he picked her up, and he took her in the house, and he called me.
Yes.
You know, so within 3 minutes, I knew that my mom had fallen and was on the ground.
Wow.
So I ran down to the house, and I said, so, Mom, what's going on? She's like, what's the matter? I said, were you on the ground? That was about 5 minutes ago. How did you know that? I said, Mom, I got my spies spying on you. I said, let me check you out.
What a network.
I said, I looked her over, and she was fine. She says, I didn't fall, Mill. I just sat on the ground because I felt myself falling.
At least she knew to do that.
Yeah, so I was like, well, okay.
Yeah.
So, but she was like, that was 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And you're already here.
Wow, it's like you're a small-town girl with big connections.
I do.
Big love.
Yes.
Yeah, for everybody.
I do.
Yeah.
Well, you know, because you get more with a positive and love than you do with negatives and hate. It's not...
Mm-hmm.
I'm just not a hater.
Mm-hmm.
Don't have it in me.
No.
You like that?
Not about it.
No.
So
I know you keep busy. You're always helping people. It must be so rewarding and fulfilling for you to make a difference in people's lives.
I like to help. You know, and sometimes instances come up that, you know, people need help, more help than they can garner. Mm-hmm. And like with Mrs. Ryan, Kathleen, Kat, Freddie and I went in and, you know, took out Scourge from the house. But we got the Knights of Columbus on board. We cleared out the whole house. And I'm dealing with the same thing with another one of our Marsville residents right now, to help her, you know, transition. Mm-hmm. She's going to go into senior living, but right now she's living in filth. Like, so I have a cleaning company that's going to come in on Halloween and the day after, setting up the dumpster in the backyard, and we're just going to clean her out so that she can, you know, live. Right. In a clean environment, because when you're not living in a clean environment, it's not healthy. And but she's, you know, she has some mental limitations too that, you know, have gotten her into this situation where she's living this way. So we're helping her through the mental end, through the area on aging, agency on aging. And then, you know, she's worried about her cat, so I'm going to have a cat, little cat carrier, so that when we come in to take things and throw them away, that she can be in charge, and she can, you know, it's her. And I tell her, this is your dilemma that you're in, but we're going to help you to get out of it. And she's scared, but she's happy that someone's there, but then she's scared, you know, it's hard. Right. So I just, my phone, like, is always open.
Right.
You know, when she calls, she says, nobody will talk to me. I says, Kath, you call me anytime and I'll talk to you. And she's like, okay. And she does. She calls me, and it's like, sometimes I look at the phone and I say, do I have 20 minutes? You know, and it's like, I'll make 20 minutes.
Well, that's what I was thinking. You work, you do all these volunteer activities. What about me time or family time? And how do you feed your own soul and your own health?
Well, I listen to myself. Like, yes. I mean, I have a pacemaker.
You do.
I had thyroid cancer. I had a scare of cervical cancer.
Oh my gosh.
And I've had feet surgeries. But you know, it's like you listen to your body. You listen to your body. Your body tells you what you need. Like, you know, if you're exhausted, you have to go to sleep. If you, you know, if you feel run down or you feel something, like I had a little nodule here.
Uh-huh.
And the doctor said, it's nothing. You know, it's just a thyroid cyst. And for a year, he was just measuring it. And so I said, I'm going to go see someone else. So I went to see my ENT, and he said, it's a thyroid cyst, Mel. If you were my wife, I would say, don't worry about it. You know, it's a thyroid cyst.
Okay.
I said, Bill, I'm not your wife. Take it out and call me at work. That's when I worked at the Trenton Times. I said, call me at work. Tell me that it was just a thyroid cyst. He calls me at work, leaves a message on my machine. Mel, it's cancer. We got to go in and check that thyroid.
Oh my gosh, just knew.
Yeah, $9,999. I went in for a biopsy of the thyroid, and they ended up taking the thyroid and like 6 to 8 lymph nodes until it got clear. So I went in for a biopsy, and I wake up with a chest tube, a breathing machine. I'm like, what's going on? They're like, oh, good, you can talk. I'm like, good, I can talk. They said, yeah, sometimes when we take the thyroid, it affects your I said, you're supposed to buy it. No, we went in, it was encrusted with cancer. We had to take it
and
until
they got
it was clear.
All.
Everything, yeah.
Oh my
so I've been
gosh.
Cancer-free for since 99.
I didn't know all that.
Yeah.
God bless you.
You're
just, and you keep on going, going, going.
Absolutely.
I can't ever picture you like numbing out to Netflix.
No.
How is your family with it? Are they supportive?
Oh, yes. My family is with me, you know, 200%. It gives me peace and it calms my heart to help others.
Yes.
If I'm helping others, it's God's way of saying, this is your path, Mel. It's not an easy one all the time, but it's your path, and it's what he's chosen for me, and I accept it, and I embrace it.
Mm-hmm. That's so nice. It's beautiful. I embrace it.
I do.
Yes. So one thing I wanted to mention about you, you're always posting on Facebook, I'm heading to Giant today.
Yes.
Come visit me. And I wonder how many people come.
Let's see how many likes and views we got today. Oh, that was somebody coming out. I had to help her. She needs a new floor in her house. So 55 people commented on the post. And when I go to work at Giant, it's like, you kiss everyone that comes through your line. I say, well, they're mostly all my relatives because I live in this town. So people that come in, I'm either related to them, they're married to a relative, or they're somebody that's my friend that I've known forever. And Marsville's a huggy kissy.
It's so much fun.
Yes.
Yes. Well, I think Giant should pay you a commission for everyone who comes in and buys things at the store because, you know, you're But referring people there.
I like working at Giant. I mean, anybody can do it, you know, ring up a barcode and stuff. So when a customer comes through the line at Giant and I see that they're, you know, a little down or something, it just seems to be bothering them, I ask them, you know, how are you today? And, you know, how was your day? And when the little kids come through, it's like, so how was school? Are you good to your teachers? You know, and the moms and dads like that I engage with the kids.
Yeah.
But some people, like, they're not real happy, and I like when everyone leaves my line at Giant that they leave and they leave a little higher than they came in, you know, a little happier or a little lighter.
Right.
And a lot of times they say, I wait in your line. Like sometimes I have, my line has like four customers and other cashiers are available. They're like, nope, I'm waiting for Milli. And I'm like, okay. And I'm blowing kisses back, and they're like, and they come through and they get their hugs. And it's funny because like one customer says, I've noticed that you've kissed like three of the customers that were in front of me. Am I getting one? I said, of course you are. I didn't even know that, you know, so I give them back on the cheek and, you know.
Right.
And it's like, wow, this is a great store. But I like John. I mean, I worked at grocery store since I was 15 when I worked at Center Fruit. And, you know, doing the
food, store business for a long time.
Yeah, food. Yeah. And then I went banking. For about 8 years, I worked for Marsville Bank when it was Marsville Bank.
Okay.
Back in the day. And then I worked for the newspaper for 15 years. And then I had Jeffrey at 42. Oh,
yes.
Now I'm just giving my age away. Right?
Yes.
That's okay. I like who I am.
Well, I have a young one at home. Well, she's in college now, but we're one of the few in our age bracket Marsville who have the youngest.
Yeah.
I didn't have my first son until I was 37.
I had my first one at 30, my second one at 42.
Wow. Yeah. So it can happen.
Yes.
And we can handle it. We can. Love it. Yes.
If he gave me another one today, I would embrace that. Uh-huh. You know, I'd probably be hitting my psychiatrist, but
Well, I'm sure you would get help because all the people you help would come back.
Oh my heavens, yes.
Yes.
And yes. Mm-hmm. It's a karma thing.
Yes.
Because good karma, spreading good karma only comes back to
you. Right, all those connections.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's what counts.
Yeah. And I have a lot of connections. And I also help with a nonprofit, the Christmas Gala in Bristol.
Okay.
Which is it helps seniors. It's called the Christmas Gala, but we help them all year long.
Uh-huh.
We help them, you know, if they move into an apartment, we'll buy their sheets, buy their towels, get them curtains, you know, and then silverware, plates, whatever they need. So they know that they can contact us and we will help in as we can.
Yeah.
But we reach out to other agencies. So it's like, you know, getting the whole community together to help. It. Clinton always said, you know, it takes a village, and it really does take a village.
Mm-hmm.
And if the whole village is working together, it just is a happy village, and that's what I like.
Mm-hmm. Well, I want to acknowledge you for this gift that you have, this gift of just shining a light. When you walk in a room, you just develop this quick attraction to people. And you make them smile and light up and talk. And not everyone can do that.
Mm.
I mean, can you imagine yourself walking into a room and holding yourself back from saying hello or smiling at people? No, you couldn't. It just comes out naturally.
I think it's from being part of a great big family that makes me more boisterous.
Uh-huh.
Because you had to be loud to be heard.
Yes.
You know, you know, and you had to sit in the middle of the table and reach both ends to get some food.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, I think, coming from a large family. And like my uncle, my father's brother, was also raised in, had his family in Marsville. So he had seven Kerner children as well.
Okay.
So there was, you know, a Kerner on every corner.
Yes.
And, but, you know, you can get lost sometimes with the multitude of people. So you have to make yourself be seen and be heard.
Right.
And then my aunts would come and uncle, children need to be seen and not heard. And I'm like, well, not in this family, they don't.
But not everyone in your family is the way you are.
No, I mean,
you were just born a certain way.
Yes.
And it's great that you use your gift. You share it with other people.
I do. Because I like lifting people up.
Yes. Okay, quickly, Mildred, I would like to ask you some quick random questions.
Okay.
Yes. What's your superpower?
My superpower. I guess my superpower will be happiness.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I feel like God has instilled much happiness in me, which mm-hmm. I'm able to share with others.
Yes.
That's a superpower.
Okay. What gets you fired up or energized each morning?
Well, each morning when I get up, I look out my window in my bathroom, and our property backs up to the wooded area, and I look for my cardinal, and most every morning I look out and I see a cardinal, and it just reminds me of my daughter. So I say my prayers out the back window, and that gives me my boost in the morning. I say, thank you, Holy Spirit, for my sign, and thank you, God, for my life and my faith, and say a Hail Mary, and start my day.
That's beautiful. Okay, if you could name a street after yourself, what would you call it?
Oh, I think we'd be on Milli Way.
Milli Way, okay. And do you have a most recent favorite product?
Most recent favorite product? Oh, I found a new shampoo. And it's called Suave with keratin infusion.
And it's for colored
hair. And it's wonderful.
Wow. I'll have to try. I'm always searching.
Yes, and it's so cheap.
Because
I've been paying like $8-$9 for this other stuff, and it's like, this is like fabulous.
Yes.
I love it.
Yes. Just makes your day, doesn't it?
It just makes my day, yes.
I am still searching for a mascara that does not smudge or run.
Oh,
I've been
searching
for years. They say waterproof, and they're not.
No.
All the time I'm wiping under my eyes. Do you have a nickname?
They call me Marvelous. Marvelous, like Billy Crystal. I used to say that when I was, even back in high school. It was like, how you doing? You Marvelous.
Marvelous. That was a great song. Yeah, that's awesome. Do you have any tattoos?
I do not have any tattoos.
No tattoos.
Okay. Millie always wanted me to get a tattoo. She was tatted all the way down, and I'm like, I don't like needles. No tattoos.
Tattoos. Can you impersonate anyone really well?
I do Billy Crystal. You look marvelous. Not only you look marvelous, you smell marvelous, darling.
Name one thing you would like to do someday.
Someday, I would like to hit the lottery for a big old jackpot.
That would be nice. And I bet I can guess what you would do with it.
Share it with everyone.
Yes, you would. Yes. Tell us something not many people know about you.
Not many people know that I went to Africa.
Oh.
Yeah. We used to have a house in Spain. You don't know that either.
No.
Grandmom Curry, Millie's grandmom. Mrs. Curry used to be our English teacher.
I see pictures of you with Mrs. Curry all the time.
And while we went over to Spain, I jumped on an airboat and went over to Africa for the day.
Wow.
And that was pretty cool. I mean, we think things are old here in America. Uh-huh. Over there, you know, things are like 5,000 years old. And I got lost in Africa. I was following the tour. They said, you had one Eddie Murphy. And I came out of a shop that I spent a little too much time in.
Right.
And there was no tour guides. And I'm like, I guess I look like the deer in headlights. And this woman comes up and she says, were you with that group? And I was like, do I say yes? I'm an American in Africa, you know. And it was in 1999.
Okay.
And I'm like, okay, God, I'm going to tell her yes.
Yes.
So I said to
her, did she help you?
I said to her, yes, I was with, she says, okay, follow me. So I follow this woman, and we're in Africa, right? It's old, it's dirt roads and cobblestones, and she takes me to this building, old building, you know, and she opens up the doors, and she says, they're up on the second floor. I'm like, I see this chair in the middle of the floor with the light bulb and the water dripping down. So I go up the steps and I open up the door and I looked in and there's my group. I'm like,
They were there.
Whatever they sold, I bought a rug, a $500 rug, but it's up in my hallway now. But it's a very nice rug from Africa. And everything that came by, I bought because I was so thankful that I found my group again and I wasn't in this wooden chair with the light bulb and the dripping water.
My gosh.
So, yes, I got lost in Africa. That's something nobody knows.
That's right. Oh, my gosh, that was a cool story. Okay, now I'm going to take you back and ask you to say something nice or true about yourself. I am blank.
I am a lover of humanity. I am happy to be alive. I'm grateful. I'm grateful for my life. And I'm blessed. I'm thoroughly blessed by friendships and family and just life in general. I'm very blessed.
Well, you said it all, Mildred. Milli.
There you go.
And I really appreciate you doing this interview today. Squeezing me into your schedule after
yes,
work.
So now I'm going to leave here. I have to go to CHOP down in Philly because my nephew's in there. He's on a CPAP machine. He's got the RSV virus.
Oh.
Freddie's daughter had it, but she got released. But Katie's still down at CHOP, so I'm going to go down and visit with her. Then I'm going to go up to Abington for a Halloween party. And then I'll be...
That's what I mean. That's what I mean. And I'll see it all on Facebook.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Yeah. By the way, Mildred has over almost 1,500 followers on Facebook. And everybody's always liking and commenting.
I know. I have like 300 that are waiting. Or like.
Oh, wow.
It's a lot that are waiting, but I
what do you
with
mean,
all
waiting?
The waiting to be my friend.
Oh.
And I think that they are my friend, and so I don't want viruses
to
come up, you know.
Sometimes
so
you
I
get
have
this, yes.
Yeah. So I've been kind of hesitant about
unless
somebody says I've been waiting, and then I look. I say okay, we're friends now.
Yeah.
Because you know, there's a lot of
too much of that.
Yeah. Because I mean, they told me that I have a separate Facebook page out there then. Only now, because I never opened any other ones.
Can't they just keep it untouched?
Yeah. You know,
unblemished.
But
anyway, that's a lot of followers, and I enjoy your posts. You put pictures of your girls' trip to the Poconos.
Yeah, we'll be heading down to Wildwood next month for my birthday. We just went for Wendy LaRue's birthday last month, and November 14th to the 17th, Thursday to Sunday, we're going down to LBI.
Awesome.
And I have
LBI, not
LBI. Wildwood? Yeah, LBI. We go. LBI. We used to have a house in LBI.
Okay.
So we go down to LBI and.
So nice.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Beach LBI. Haven or.
Ship Bottom,
right over the bridge.
Mm-hmm.
How nice. Yeah. Well, keep on having fun.
I will.
And shining your light, and I'll be watching, and all those people out there are so. Lucky to have you in their lives.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Now you can drink that beer.
There you go.
Hey, thanks for watching. Hope you learned a few things from this special guest. Remember, we all have gifts to use and share. My purpose is to invite you to take some action on the ideas and inspiration of each woman to make a difference in your own life and on those around you. Please like the Facebook page and subscribe and ring the bell on YouTube. I know it's so annoying to find that darn password, but then you'll get a whole catalog of the Just Us Grown Up Girls interviews. Thank you, and I truly appreciate you.